and self-aggrandizement. In nation building, Kwame Bediakon observes, what is needed is not mere Christian testimony, but a testimony that is essentially prophetic. The appeal to supernatural sources for meaning making in our problems, is not the preserve of Ghanaians. Matthews Ojo writes that in Nigeria, the causes of the nation's ill health are generally explained in terms of satanic and demonic activities and the sins of her citizens. The most potent remedy that Christians have adopted to solving the nation's problems, he notes, is to organize prayers for the nation based on the promise of God in 2 Chronicles 7:14. We require a certain critical sense of humility and self-introspection to appreciate why, despite the perennial calls for fasting and prayer and repentance, according to 2 Chronicles 7:14, Africa does not appear to be making progress. The prophet Ezekiel puts the matter even more succinctly. He says, they come to you as people come, and they sit before you as my people, and they hear your words, but they will not obey them. For flattery is on their lips, but their heart is not on their game. End of quote. Here in this lecture, I make references to other religious traditions, but the aim has been to examine the ways in which, as a Christian majority country, Ghana has not been able to translate faith into practical everyday action for the flourishing of people in society. James, in his epistle to the church, says, religion that is pure and undefiled before God is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. The expression widows in this context refers to the vulnerable, that is those who have been left on the margins of society, the elderly, pensioners, orphans, the financially disadvantaged, and other such people whose lot in life depends directly on the decisions of those who wield political power and who oversee governance systems. To cite a quick example of what I'm driving at, we know that the result of the 2022 junior high school examinations and the placements in senior high schools have both been released. The professed logic behind the computerized placement system is now lost on parents, and it's been so for many years. It's not the problem of this government. Many are grieving, and they've been grieving for a very long time, because their children may have performed better than others placed in very highly placed, high graded schools. What makes the difference, even in this system of computerized placement, is not the result or merit, but as I have come to learn, it is who are on the protocol lists. When merit is protocolized, what you reap at the end is corrupt leaders who think that, like their parents, they can use connections to achieve anything in life. If our hearts are set on evil and destruction, travels in prayer become exercises in futility. In other words, my response to the popular question of why we have so much religion around and within us, and yet find that our governance systems are not working, is that we have turned Christianity, which is a prophetic religion, into a mystical one. Mystics claim supernatural knowledge for self-importance, but prophets, I mean genuine prophets, speak the mind of God for the common good. When politics and governance are carried out in a prophetic manner, they go on a world-altering mission. Wolf, among others, refers to the case of Moses, who ascended Mount Sinai and returned as a deliverer of Israel from their despicable exilic conditions. Jesus, who as a transcendent being made flesh through the incarnation, came to mend a world plagued by evil. He came from above and delivered healing and redemption. In the mystical approaches to faith, God's name is taken in vain in violation of the third commandment in the Decalogue. In faith that is prophetic, there is plucking up and pulling down, destroying and overthrowing, but these are followed by building and planting. Here is John the Baptist on how to experience healing in our politics and governance through conscious, decisive actions against corrupt behavior. And I quote him from Luke 3, 10 to 14. And the crowd asked him, "What then should we do?" In reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone. Whoever has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." Soldiers also asked him, "And we, what should we do?" He said to them, "Do not extort money from anyone by threat or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages." End of quote. In the expression of religion today, rather than stay authentically prophetic, those claiming to have been anointed with that grace only deceive their souls by attempts to flatter God and his people with flowery words and language. They engage in exercises of naming and claiming, make dubious prophetic declarations, and specialize in scandalizing Christianity. This is done by predicting doom for public figures and people of substance for the enhancement of personal profiles and to feed their egoistic pastoral ambitions. There is much prophetic religion in our land, but although by no means all, their immersion into the political and governance system has not been of much effect. Jeremiah, the prophet, talks about false prophets who were unable to challenge the moral decay of their time because they were complicit in the evils of society. In his words, they prophesied by Baal and led God's people astray. The history of the relationship between religion on the one hand and politics and governance on the other has, since the beginning of the independence era, been a very formidable one. The Ghana national anthem, "God Bless Our Homeland Ghana," professes faith in the sovereignty of God and in his supremacy over national affairs. The anthem, one of the richest in the world in terms of religious content, speaks to the availability of divine guidance and resources in making our nation great and strong. It is also not unusual for the custodians of our religio-cultural traditions to petition the ancestors for prosperity for the land. The other traditional symbols of state, the presidential chair, the state sword, and our constitution, including the current one, all demonstrate our religious orientation as a people, and above all, most public office holders swear their oath of office on the Bible, or in the case of Muslims, on the Quran. An intriguing mystical activity in governance is the ritual elimination of evil. Exorcising people, systems, and places to free them from evil towards prosperity is a national obsession. When Ghana's first president, Kwame Nkrumah, was overthrown in the immediate post-colonial era in 1966, the new military government invited Prophet Charles K. Wovenu of the Apostles' Revelation Society to exorcise the Osu Castle of demonic spirits before occupancy. The belief then was that the religiously enigmatic president Nkrumah, through his alleged association with various traditional shrines and occult fraternities, had spiritually contaminated the seat of government, rendering the place unsafe for the new military junta. Wonder why they didn't shoot the demons. James Fernandez, who has written extensively on this issue, observes that such an activity at the dawn of the post-colonial era raised problems of the persistence of traditional religious worldviews and the relevance of religious leaders and religion to contemporary ruling elites and their task of mobilization and modernization. This belief in religious mysticism in African politics, alongside the issues of corruption and self-serving decisions at the highest level of governance, which are common across Africa, offer a further context for the substance of this lecture, Healing Our Politics. To heal in the context of ill health is to restore to proper functioning order by firstly arriving at the right diagnosis and secondly prescribing and applying the right medication. In terms of the ritual cleansing of seats of governments to solve national problems, we have had analogous developments of that nature in other African countries. In Zambia, President Frederick Chiluba, after taking office in 1991, caused a group of Pentecostal pastors to spiritually cleanse the seat of government before occupancy. This was due to the popular belief that the immediate post-colonial president of the country, Kenneth Kaunda, himself a contemporary of Nkrumah, had also governed with the assistance of mystical powers. Chiluba proceeded to make the following declaration, and I quote him, "On behalf of the people of Zambia, I repent of our wicked ways of idolatry, witchcraft, the occult, immorality, injustice, and corruption. I pray for the healing, restoration, revival, blessing, and prosperity of Zambia." When Chiluba lost power, it came as a surprise to those who believed in his Christian credentials that public office had corrupted his Christian values. The general belief that ubiquitous mystical forces are enlisted in the African political order and governance systems, and the creation of ritual contexts to nullify their effects is common practice. It is neither a psychological delusion nor the figment of anyone's imagination. The unfortunate bit here is that in many cases, there seems to be a disconnect between the invocation of God's name to further political interests and what people do when power is given them. General Ike Achampong, who came to power in January 72, in addition to professing a Catholic faith, also allegedly courted the services of mystics and several independent church prophets. The corruption and moral decay that occurred within SMC 1 and 2 were legendary. But even here, mystical interpretations were used to diagnose national problems. In the early weeks of the coup d'etat, and presumably under the direction of his mystic mentors, the then Colonel Achampong ordered the Black Star removed from all state establishments bearing that designation and logo. When Kwame Nkrumah chose the Black Star as Ghana's symbol, the political philosophy was to present Africa and Ghana specifically as a rising, shining star in the world's political and economic order. The use of the symbol of that vision, the Black Star, was reversed by General Achampong when Ghana's shipping line, the Black Star Line, was renamed the National Shipping Line. That was also when the Black Star Square became Independence Square. And even the nation's soccer team, the Black Stars, was renamed the national team. It is the mystical reasoning for changing the names of Ghana's iconic post-colonial institutions that are important for us. And this is stated clearly by John S. Obi. He says, "The reason for giving the order was that the source of Ghana's ill since independence was the Black Star, a symbol of ill luck, evil luck. This was presumably divined by a champion spiritual powerhouse. That order was as radical as it was superstitious." End of quote. The heady days of Ghana's corrupted political systems, moral decline, and economic collapse of the 1970s eventually led to the 1979 June 4th revolution under Jerry Rawlings. The revolution itself was defined in religious nomenclature when it was referred to as a holy war with a lot of human blood spilled in the name of cleansing the nation of ritual filth of corruption. President Rawlings himself constantly challenged those who doubted his integrity to test his credibility at the shrine. It's a matter of public knowledge that President John Atta Mills, who succeeded President Kufuor, not only became an important client of the late T.B. Joshua of Nigeria, but also set up a regular Sunday afternoon church service inside the seat of government, the Osu Castle. Professor Mills was a practicing conservative evangelical Christian and brought his faith to bear on governance. His religious intentions were lofty. At the very least, Ghanaians helped him up as a man of integrity who translated his preaching of peace into practical action. He, at some point, even made a public statement like the one made by President Chiluba, declaring Ghana a Christian nation and wishing that the whole country was one big prayer camp. President Mills, against the backdrop of his evangelical faith, also made it clear that he abhorred the pouring of libation at state functions, believing, as most exponents of healing and deliverance do, that traditional libation pouring constitutes a demonic doorway into national affairs. Along these lines of thought, in Ghana's post-colonial history, Christian leaders and ecumenical bodies have often called for prayer and fasting towards the resolution of ecological problems, economic downturns, and so on. We have mentioned General Champon and his interest in using prophetic figures in the process of governance. At the prompting of a popular Ghanaian evangelist at the time, Champon in 1977 called for a week of national repentance. The reason was that the ills of the nation, political and economic, were due to the sinfulness of the citizenry. John Espoby helps us to understand why some Ghanaians have always been skeptical of such calls for fasting and prayer and weeks of repentance. He said at the time, the particular timing of the message was calculated to divert attention from the real problems of Ghana. The government itself had been incompetent and corrupt and had been mishandling the business of the nation. No policy was ever carried through. The step then diverted attention from the misdeeds of the political leaders. End of quote. That is the crux of the matter and the reason why our politics needs a healing balm. Corruption is a monumental problem and has become demonic, not simply in a mystical sense, but also in the monstrous nature of it. The historic mission churches refused to participate in the national Thanksgiving service of Champon on account of their belief that the man himself was not taking good care of the public purse. We still continue to rely on our faith. There is nothing wrong with that. But what I'm calling for is to bridge the gap between the prophetic faith that we seek to profess and what we do as a nation. Just a couple of weeks ago, I had the occasion to call a member of the opposition party. There are many opposition parties, so I won't tell you which one. He had come on radio to insult the president, to insult some members of the Supreme Court. I didn't call him directly. I called his pastor. And I said to him, this man comes into your church. I have seen you anoint him. I saw it myself. And then I named Supreme Court judges who were fellows of this academy. And I asked him, when some of them passed out as lawyers, you hadn't been born. So tell your church member that if he wants to be a Christian, he should be a good one. Because basic etiquette does not allow you to insult your elders. In the African public sphere, everyone complains about corruption. And this within the context of the abundance of prayer, fasting, and calls for repentance. Unfortunately, the diagnosis of national problems take place, not necessarily with proven political and governance principles in mind as corrective measures, but against the backdrop of mystical beliefs. When elections are looming, we pray. When the economy is failing, we call for prayer and fasting. At the outbreaks of epidemics and pandemics, we seek answers, sometimes not in health and sanitation or even medical experiments gone awry, but in curses and God's anger with immorality, ancestral practices, and lately even in homosexual acts and behavior. When the value of our currency is plummeting, there are invocations of supernatural interventions from heaven to arrest dwarfs, demons, and spirits supposedly interfering in and tampering with the economic fortunes of the nation. This has happened many times. Even in 2015, thereabout, it happened. Studies in other African jurisdictions, like Nigeria, have proven that African democratic processes are ultimately inexplicable, apart from references to the influence of Pentecostal charismatic Christianity. And this is evident both through the rising political influence of Pentecostal pastors and the movement's popular tendency to view sociopolitical problems in spiritual terms. This omnipresent nature of religion in African affairs and systems of thought did not develop as a byproduct of modernity. The man whose intellectual legacy we celebrate in these lectures, J.B. Damkwa, wrote that the quest for God in Akan land is a quest for their culture, their politics, their economies, and the spirit of their art and life. I have pointed out elsewhere in other publications that with the worldview of mystical causality etched in the philosophical psyche of the African, Ghana offered traditional religious sacrifices to a river deity when in the early 1980s, a train disaster that claimed many lives occurred at Esuya near Koforidua in the eastern region. This was during the presidency of Dr. Hilary Mann. Sadly, it was later discovered that because of some earlier derailment in the area, two technical reports commissioned by previous governments, one local, the other international, had both recommended a remodeling of the portion of the rail line where the accident occurred. The technical advice had been ignored in favor of religious ritual to appease an angry deity, Esuya. In the late 1990s, when the national airline Ghana Airways was going down, a whole prayer meeting was called, at which the chief executive of the company was handed a fiscal sword by a charismatic evangelist to decimate the demons causing the downfall of the prime legacy of Kwame Nkrumah's independent Ghana. And one can go on and on, but let me conclude. We have noted how Ghana has been accustomed to the reliance on the services of all kinds of prophetic figures, sometimes with devious Christian pedigrees, and who, exploiting the vulnerabilities of persons in authority and the fears and insecurities of our citizenry, make decrees and declarations out of human imagination and not in the wisdom and counsel of God. There was a prophetic declaration recently. I have gone back to check. And the person who gave that prophecy said the same thing 20 years ago. What has made our national cause even more precarious is having secured the mandate to govern, we seem to suddenly freeze our divinely endowed intellectual capacities to think and act, and sometimes even behave as if the problems of today started only yesterday. Having consulted these mystical realms for help, we then take decisions based on self-serving prophetic declarations rather than on the timely principles of development that science, technology, and the human values of honesty, integrity have taught humanity constitute the means of national development. We have sought to argue in these lectures that as a country in which religion abounds, the deployment of mystical resources towards national causes may be considered an inevitable part of our lives. However, the simplistic attributions of our problems to the machinations of demons and the reliance on mystics for solutions to national problems has serious downsides. It blinds us to the empirical source of our problems. Spiritual disciplines degenerate into escapist mechanisms and absorb decision makers from taking personal and collective responsibility for actions that jeopardize the collective destinies of our people. That means, if we desire healing in our politics, the nation must hold itself accountable regarding how faith is used within the public sphere. Win an election, you go to church to thank God, and when we are investigating, or let's say the nation is investigating the way you have used resources, you say, politically motivated. When we allow governments to hide behind religious slogans and mystical worldviews in the declarations of weeks of national repentance, visitations to churches and mosques for divine endorsement and blessings, we only succeed in diverting attention from the core issues. The wrongful use of religious resources simplistically creates direct connections between national problems and national sins. But without the element of repentance that ensures that wrongs are righted by taking direct responsibility for our actions, the attempts by the Ghana Pentecostal Council to emulate the historic example of the Christian Council of Ghana and the Catholic Bishops' Conference to deal with social justice issues, and a determination to participate both in the transformation of social structures through effective political action, is the way to heal the politics of the land. The systems of the modern world function based on a particular kind of rationality, not simply on the invocation of supernatural assistance. It may be asked whether a form of religion so manifestly different in its explanatory processes can contribute greatly to the rationality that the modern world introduced and seemingly requires. The nation bastardizes an important biblical passage when we appeal to 2 Chronicles 7:14 as reason to fast and pray, but without the accompanying hermeneutic of what it means to be a people who are called by God's name and turn from evil towards the righteousness of God. When we bear the name of God, we bear his image and identity. And from a Christian viewpoint, we metamorphosize into new creations in Christ. Prayer and fasting, unaccompanied by heartfelt repentance and the resolve to challenge ourselves on our moral record of social injustices, ethnocentricities, religious bigotry and homophobia, rampant and shameless corruption and laziness, would only amount to exercises in futility. In the words of one of Ephraim Amu's compositions, Ibibrima, if we continue like this, the other nations will leave us lagging behind at the rear. Thank you for your attention.
now it's time to give an applause to our speaker. This is a very inspirational speech and a great introspection, because it is not always that we get a Reverend Prof very much into Christianity telling us what we really need to do to make Christianity a major force in transforming the country. He says, We are religious people, and he laid a foundation as to why that is so, from the chieftaincy, the ancestral beliefs, and all of that. And correct, right? And it's it's embedded in the life of our people. Then there's the contradiction, which is that we are religious, we are educated, but we don't do the right thing. We are not very moral beings. And then we try to use religion, what he calls the mystical religion, as a means of aggrandizement for power, for material acquisitions, and so on. And of course, the politicians also do the same thing, where they use power to acquire material things and to lord over us. What I hear, and I think I call it an introspection, is that we can pray, it should be the beginning. By the end of it, nothing will change if we don't hold ourselves accountable and try to do things to change what we think is wrong. I think that is a key message. And I'm happy that he's articulating that, because it is a conversation that the pastor, the leaders community should have, that we don't solve our problems simply by telling the city to elevate itself, right? Doesn't do that. Or that if we get a technical report, we set it aside and don't do anything about it and hope that the solution will go away. It doesn't work that way. So that is the healing, the restoration issue that he's talking about, that we need to do something, not just pray, to end corruption, to end epidemics, or to get our currency to appreciate. So then he talks about the prophetic religion. And I think that is where he's really trying to go, where you use it as a moral thing, as a way of renewal for, what do we call it? Justice, social justice, and so on. Now, there was a part I found quite interesting, that we set up a computerized placement system. And then, as if we don't know ourselves, we put in a self-destructive mechanism, protocol. And sooner or later, the protocol expands, and it devours the whole process. So it's as if we must also know ourselves and put in and prevent those things that will eventually self-destruct what we're trying to do. So I think it's a great conversation, and I really will hope that Professor Mwajedu will lead the that he will lead this discussion, because I think we need to go there. Because I think many people have felt that once they pray, that's the end of it. Then they've done their business. But I think he's telling us we should go to the higher level and try to do stuff that will help to move us where we should really go. So I enjoyed the talk. It's very, very inspiring. I think it has a lot of value, and it should go on. It's really the beginning, and it should go on. And I really appreciate the effort he has put in to structure this process for us so that we can go home with great ideas and to our communities and to our churches and say, hey, it's not enough to simply pray for it. It's not going to go away. We've got to do something about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Chair. Another round for our chairman. Thank you. And we have come to the end of tonight's event. I have a few announcements, but before then I'd like to acknowledge the schools who are with us here, students from the various schools, and they are at Trinity Theological Seminary, the speaker's own school. And we have the School of Theology from Pentecost University. Students from the Akrofi Christola Institute. We thank you all for being here with us tonight. And we look forward to having you again for the next 2 days when the lectures continue. Tomorrow, at the same time, here in this auditorium, our speaker will give his second lecture in this J.B. Dankwa Lecture Series 2023 on the topic Healing Our People, Contemporary Christianity, Citizenship, and Governance in Ghana. It promises to be another very exciting lecture. Do join us again tomorrow, 5:30. PM here in the auditorium. I'd like to thank everyone here and those who have joined us online, our fellows, our invited guests, and everybody. Thank you for joining us this evening. And we look forward to having you again. And the Reverend has reminded me that I must not forget to mention refreshments. So very important, nourishment for the soul and for the body. Very good reminder, thank you. So there will be refreshment served in the foyer. So as you leave, please, make sure that you get something to refresh you before you go home. Now, I'd ask you to please stand while I usher the speaker and the chair out of the room. Thank you very much. Thank you.
and experience a stimulating Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences presents Series 56 of the J.B. Dankwa Memorial Lectures. Topic: African Politics and the Mystical Realm, Religion and Governance in Postcolonial Ghana. The lecture will cover Healing Our Politics, Healing Our People, Healing Our Currency. Speaker: Reverend Professor J. Kwabena Asamoah-Jedu, President, Trinity Theological Seminary, Legon, Fellow of the Academy. Dates: 20th to 22nd February 2023. Time: 5:30 p.m. daily. Venue: Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, Casely Hayford Road, Airport Residential Area, Accra. Come and experience a stimulating discussion. Academy of Arts and Sciences presents Series 56 of the J.B. Dankwa Memorial Lectures. Topic: African Politics and the Mystical Realm, Religion and Governance in Postcolonial Ghana. The lecture will cover Healing Our Politics, Healing Our People, Healing Our Currency. Speaker: Reverend Professor J. Kwabena Asamoah-Jedu, President, Trinity Theological Seminary, Legon, Fellow of the Academy. Dates: 20th to 22nd February 2023. Time: